Yeah. Good morning.
Good morning.
Hear the psalmist as they say, "Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Burst into jubilant song with music. Make music to the Lord with the harp and the sound of singing, with trumpets and the blast of the ram's horn. Shout for joy before the Lord, the King." We're so grateful that you're here with us today. Welcome to Music Sunday. We're glad that you're here with us in person. We're glad that you can join with us online. We are here to worship our God who moves us to sing in songs of joy and praise, and we will do so together. Let us prepare our hearts and minds for worship. Just a few announcements as we begin our worship. As you will notice, we will have a wonderful music-filled worship service. The musicians have been, some of them are songs that we've sung throughout the year. Some of them are brand new to us for the today, but all of them are beautiful, beautiful music pieces. So I'm just grateful for all of the musicians that we have here with us today, for all the work that you've done, for the ways in which you enhance our worship, and the ways in which you move our faith. Thank you, thank you, thank you. I hope that all of you will plan on joining us afterwards for a reception down in the fellowship hall. In addition to preparing all this beautiful music for the service, the musicians have also planned a special reception. So we hope that you'll come and enjoy goodies and fellowship and take a moment to tell them in person how much you appreciate their ministry. We have an announcement from the governing board.
Good morning. I'm here this morning on behalf of the governing board. We'd like to try to come to you approximately once a month just to kind of give you a quick update of what we've been doing and on behalf of the congregation and the issues we've been discussing and so on. As you may be aware, the minutes of the governing board meetings are posted on the bulletin board, and they're also online, available in the weekly announcements. So we urge you to read those minutes and comment to us if you have any ideas or concerns or anything that might be able to help us. So I will try to make this brief because I'm sure you want to get to the music and you don't want to hear me sing. One of the efforts we've been working hard on so far is to work closely with the church teams. The teams are really valuable to the church, and we've been working with them to update their responsibilities, their mission, and their memberships. Each team also has one governing board member assigned to them as a liaison person to help the communication between the teams and the governing board. This year, we have teams Worship and Music, which is chaired by Dave Morris, Technology, which is chaired by Andy Bonecutter, Youth and Family Ministry, the chairperson is Chris, Property chairperson is Joe, Budget and Finance chairperson is Michael Ann Adams, Mission, the chairperson of that team is Greg, and Outreach, the person there, the chairperson is Dawn. Hospitality and Care is chaired by Bruce Shreve, and Personnel is chaired by Tracy Jones. These teams are obviously valuable to the church, and we would urge you, if anybody would like to join those teams or help them in any way, please contact myself or any of the team members, and they would, I'm sure, glad to have your help. Many hands makes light work, which was exemplified by the work that was done outside the church yesterday by numerous people. I'm going to call them the Over the Hill Gang. It was Chuck and Wally, Waylon, Larry, Joe, Jim, Jerry, John, Greg, Laura, and myself. So I appreciate all the work that was done out there, and it does look beautiful. The governing board is also, of course, focusing on the church finances. As you know, Jill Pildner has done a great job as the treasurer, but she decided to step down that position this year, but will remain as financial secretary. We did hire a new treasurer, Julie Homshield, and she's training with Jill, and she's going to be a fine addition to the team. She's been on board now for a couple of months and been coming to the board meetings, and she's doing a fine job. We're looking hard at the budget and looking for any ways we can to save money. We've taken a couple of small steps. We canceled the Yellow Pages ad. I think everybody drove over their new Yellow Pages book in their driveway this week. So we canceled that ad, and we also canceled the ad in the Record Courier, a small savings. And we took away the cost of the mosquito control, although that cost was picked up then by some individuals in the church. So that's going to continue, but not at the cost of the budget. In conjunction with the finance team, we're beginning to work on the idea of pledge cards. And we're going to be coming to you more with that in the near future. Once we can more clearly define our income, we can develop a budget. Hopefully, the plan is in early November, and then get the budget to the congregation, and then have the congregational meeting in late November to approve the budget so we can have a budget based on a potential income before the end of the fiscal year or the beginning of the next fiscal year, rather than going into the following year. So hopefully that'll work, and we're going to get you all involved in that and bring that forward. We also plan to have one Sunday in the fall we're going to call Catch Up Sunday to remind our congregation of the benefits of giving. We're going to also have a midterm congregational meeting in late June. Usually, I think we've had a congregational meeting in January. We're going to have a midterm one now in late June to talk about some of these things and review them and discuss the issues and get your ideas. The governing board encourages and needs your comments and input on any of these things. And please personally contact myself or any member of the governing board anytime if you have any concerns or issues or input, anything, we're welcome to them. So thank you.
I think it's really important, the work that the governing board does on your behalf to do the ministry of the church and kind of monitor our collective ministry and missions. And you have a governing board that works so very hard and so very diligently. So thank you to the board. And I appreciate their commitment to trying to be transparent and let you know what's going on. One of the things we noticed is, you know, when we came back after COVID, our same communication strategies weren't always working and making sure that everybody knew what was happening. So I really appreciate the board giving you kind of monthly updates, and their goal is to be transparent with decisions they're making and goals that we have as a church. So I really, really appreciate your work and all of you and your help with that. This week going on at the church, we have a busy week as always. We have our Tuesday prayer meeting at noon. Magic Yarn Project will be 10:30 to 1 this Wednesday, and then our Thursday book study. A reminder that if you would like to order the book study, we'll be starting that in June, and we'll be doing that book study, it looks like, after church on Sundays and on Thursdays. So if you'd like to order a book, it's Be the Bridge, Pursuing God's Heart for Racial Reconciliation by Latasha Morrison. I think it's hard conversations, but I think they're very worthwhile conversations to have. Friday is the deadline to order the men's fellowship dinner, which will be a week from Friday on June 2nd. And a reminder that next Sunday is a very busy Sunday in the life of the church. It is Pentecost Sunday. We will be recognizing our graduate, Olivia Liggett, and celebrating her in worship. And it is also Memorial Day weekend. We encourage you all to wear red as a sign of the work of the Holy Spirit in our midst. We can show how on fire we are with the Spirit of the Lord simply by our fashion choices. So if you have some red, I encourage you to wear them. Coming up, we also have several busy weeks, and the month of June already feels like it's rushing past, even though we're not even there yet. The first Sunday in June, we will celebrate the confirmation of three of our individuals. So we hope that you'll be here to celebrate their walk of faith and their entry into being a full member of the church. And also on June 11th, we will be celebrating a baptism, and we will be having holy conversations. Number three, this is our third one. And number three is going to be kind of a little bit different than what we've done in the past. We're going to be looking at the wall of wonder, so we're going to kind of map out our timeline. But as the governing board realized at their retreat this last week, 1 hour is really not going to be enough to map the timeline. So we're going to try as a congregation to get highlights and give ourselves perspective, but we are going to invite ourselves to kind of take all summer to keep adding to the timeline so that we can kind of look at who we are as a people, who we have been, and where God is leading us. So I hope that you'll plan on staying for the Holy Conversations on June 11th after worship. As Mark said, June 25th is the congregational meeting, and that will be directly after worship as well. We'll make sure that we put that in the email newsletter and in the newsletter that goes out, but I wanted to mention it now, so if you are somebody who likes to put it in your calendar, you could do so. Did I miss any announcements? Chris. Vacation Bible School is probably one of the funnest weeks here at the church throughout the whole year, and we depend a lot on your volunteer help, so all of your help is greatly appreciated. It's a really fun theme this year, so I hope that you can participate. Thanks, Chris. Let's worship the Lord our God with all our heart, mind, soul, and strength.
Good morning.
Good morning.
It's another beautiful morning in Suffield, Ohio. We're glad you're all here. Please join with me in our call to worship. Shout for joy, sing songs of praise.
For God reigns over all the earth.
God has gone up with a shout.
Sound trumpets and singing songs of praise.
Our opening prayer, Redeeming God, you call us to be one with you as you are one with Christ. As his perfect love casts out fear and changes it to love, unite us by your spirit of peace that we may be one with you as you are one with Christ. Amen. For all those able, please rise and join with us in our opening hymn, When Morning Gilds the Skies. Confession. Now our call to confession. Friends, God not only desires our repentance, but longs to our forgiveness. Therefore, cast all your anxiety on God, because God cares for you eternally. Please join with me in our prayer of confession. Loving God, we confess we do not always bring honor and glory to your name. We are rebellious and weak.
We plead before your goodness. Forgive,
restore, and strengthen us
by your grace and mercy of Christ, that we may rise up again in peace to love and serve your world. Amen.
Our assurance of blessing. Beloved, the Spirit of God is resting on you to restore, support, and strengthen you. Therefore, be at peace in the one who forgives and loves you. Rise up and give God thanks. Peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
I think we're going to have the peace be with you now. And also with you.
Thank you. children forward. You and me, Nate. No pressure. Well, so last week we talked about how there was lots of ways to pray, right? And I've got some feedback from some of the adults in the congregation that they really appreciated that. So I thought I would show you a really cool way to pray because some of us are doodlers. This is a doodle prayer. So you take a pen, and I could make a video tutorial of this, but we're just gonna do this. And so I've got you know, fun color paper, but it could be white, doesn't matter what color. And I've got a fun colored pen, but it could be plain black for all I care. And you just doodle. Oh no, that pen's not working. All right, we'll try again. And turn it over. Oh, you're gonna try to fix it. These are Nate's favorite pens. All right, so we're just gonna doodle. And I got big, like, loops. All right, so nothing, you know, nothing fancy. You wanna do it? Just let your pen go wherever you want. Oh, you make circles the other way. I go clockwise, you went counterclockwise. Okay, that's a lot of prayers. Okay, careful. Okay, so. So somewhere in the middle there, doesn't matter which you pick, you know, one of the loops or whatever, and we're going to put God right in the middle of our thing. So when we pray, we're going to remember to pray to God. And we could draw little symbols there that make us think of God if we wanted. So we could draw a cross or a fish. You could actually, if you turn the fish the other way, it can become a dove. You just have to be a little creative and use your imagination a little. That doesn't look like a dove, but it's a dove. Yeah, we know it's a dove. All right, so we've got God there in the middle, and I just doodled a couple of things. Now, what kinds of things do we pray about? Like in the service, we have a time what we call the joys and the concerns. So do we only lift up good things? No, we lift up some things that we're worried about too, or maybe some bad things. So let's look at some good things and some bad things. It's beautiful, sunny day. So I'm gonna maybe write sun, and on the end of the sun, I'm gonna make that my sun. So I made little sun rays coming off of sun. So I can remember to thank God for nature. And then over here, I'm gonna, in this bottom one, I'm gonna write a music note, so that I can remember to thank God for all the musicians and the music and the way that it inspires me. And then actually right next to it, I'm gonna get fancy and I'm gonna write a rest note, a musical rest note, so I can thank God for just having the time to rest and take off and relax and enjoy myself. I'm gonna put in here, let's start thinking about some of the things that we're concerned about. So what's that? Okay, what's another joy? That's a very good joy. Is it okay if I share with everybody? Okay, so he said love. So he's thankful for love and all the people that he loves and all the people that love him, and he drew a little heart. So that's a great way of doodling that. I'm going to draw this kind of a red cross. It's purple, but we'll pretend it's red. And so I'm going to, yeah, there you go. We got some orange in there, orange and purple. Perfect. We can pretend it's red. So I'm going to write a couple of people that I know that are worried about their health. So my niece, your cousin Savannah, John Cain, Helen Powers. So we can just, and you can keep adding to that as we do our joys and concerns, and you can just add other people in there. And it's okay if you have too many, you can go into the next loop if you need to. There's no rules because it's your doodle. You can doodle wherever you want. Yeah. All right. What's another concern that we have? I'm going to write a tear right here so I can think of all those people that are sad. And I'm not going to put names there, but I'm just going to remember all the people that are sad or having a tough time. Maybe they're having a tough time because they lost someone they loved. Maybe they're having a tough time because they're going through difficulties, because it's hard at school or somebody's acting mean to them, or one of their coworkers is difficult to get along with. But I'm just going to remember everybody that's going through a difficult time. So that, you know, and I've still got plenty of room on my doodle prayer, but it's lots of ways. What I really like about this is sometimes we treat prayer as though we have to stress about it. And so, you know, we might do a bullet point list. You know, we have to pray for this person, this person, this person. Then what happens is if we forget somebody, we feel bad. I'm like, oh, shoot, now I have another bullet point that I have to list. And prayer is not something that you have to worry about. It's not something that you have to stress over. What it really is remembering who God is and remembering who you are and remembering that God cares about the things that you care about. And God delights in some of the same things that you take delight in. So that's the doodle prayer. And I'm going to send you back with your doodle, and you can fill it in during the joys and concerns. And I just want everybody to know, no, it's okay. Nate is praying a lot. He's got a lot of little doodles in there to fill in. That's a lot of prayer. I think it's going to be good. And one of the other ways, we're going to end our prayer together as a congregation. So musicians, you thought you were all prepared for today, but you actually have an additional job. You are going to be the second line up there, labeled musicians. So it will go pastor, musicians, congregation, or the church, and then all of us together. Because like a lot of music, worship is kind of call and response. All right? If you want to read it here, you can, Nate. You want to read the line with me? Okay. Sing to God. Kingdoms of the world. Sing praise to the Lord, to him who rides in the sky, the ancient sky. Listen to him, shout with a mighty roar. Proclaim God's power. His might is in the sky. How awesome is God as he comes from his sanctuary. The God of Israel, he gives strength and power to his people. Praise God. Thank you so much. All right, you want an extra prayer sheet? Give one to your brothers, too. Tell them that they need a little bit of prayer. Good work, Nate. Thank you.
Our gospel lesson today comes from the Gospel of John, chapter 17, verses 1 to 11. After Jesus had spoken these words, he looked up to heaven and said, "Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son so that the Son may glorify you, since you have given him authority over all people to give eternal life to all whom you have given him. And this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. I glorified you on earth by finishing the work that you gave me to do. So now, Father, glorify me in your own presence with the glory that I had in your presence before the world existed. I have made your name known to those whom you gave me from the world. They were yours, and you gave them to me, and they have kept your word. Now they know that everything you have given me is from you, for the words that you gave to me, I have given to them, and they have received them and know in truth that I came from you, and they have believed that you sent me. I am asking on their behalf. I'm not asking on behalf of the world, but on behalf of those whom you gave me, because they are yours. All mine are yours, and yours are mine, and I have been glorified in them. And now I am no longer in the world, but they are in the world, and I am coming to you. Holy Father, protect them in your name that you have given me, so that they may be one as we are one." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Will you pray with me? Loving God, we pray that your Holy Spirit will strengthen us to be devoted to the teachings of your word, that through it we may hear your voice and follow it into eternal life. Amen. Music Sunday has to be, I think, one of the best Sundays of the year, and I'm not just saying that because it means I have to write a shorter sermon, because honestly, shorter sermons are much harder to write than longer sermons. But one of the reasons that I love it is there is so much rich theology and deep faith that we find in our music. And it doesn't seem to matter to us when we sing the same songs that we've loved for years over and over again. They hit us differently at different times, and sometimes they hit us the same way that they hit us that first time we heard it. And they are all meaningful to us in various and different ways. And so as I was thinking about how to reflect on the gift that music is to our faith, I was thinking about, when we sing in Cub Scouts and when we sing funny songs, you know, we say second verse, same as the first, a little bit louder and a little bit worse. But I think in terms of faith, it gets better and better every time we sing it. But it also has variations that we sing. I sang Ubi Caritas in seminary, and it was a very different arrangement than the trio sang for us, and frankly, I prefer the one we heard today. Mine was more of a round, so it was just meant to teach us the words, not really be pretty. So the version today was beautiful. But they're the same words. They might even have been in the same key. I didn't do the research to know. They're the same notes. They're just arranged differently. And I think that that's a lot of what happens with our faith, too. We have variations on a theme. And one of the things that I was worried about when I first became a minister in the first few years of my ministry, I wrestled with worry over how I would ever begin to say something new about the gospel, something meaningful about the text, to make my sermons meaningful, to make our worship time well spent. I wanted to make sure that I gave the text its due in terms of studying it and reflecting on it and talking about what it meant for today. Gradually, though, I came to the realization that I really have the same five or six sermons that are just presented differently based on what's happening in the world. And I'm okay with that. I mean, I'm not trying to make fun of myself. I think genuinely we have some basic messages of our faith that take a while to sink down into our hearts. So sometimes we need to tell ourselves that same message over and over again. You know, one of the biggest messages we say is God is love. Well, why do we need to keep saying that? Because we have so many examples in the world of how we are not loved. We have so many examples of how we don't feel loved. And so the messages of the world run counter to the truths that we know in our faith. So we keep saying those messages because hopefully if we say it enough, we'll remember when things get really difficult. And we have a faith and a foundation to lean on. The variations and that same core message, they're important. I don't know if you've been paying attention to pop culture news recently, but Ed Sheeran had a court case recently where he was taken to court by the family of Marvin Gaye, who thought that Ed Sheeran kind of ripped off one of Marvin Gaye's melodies. And so the court case was decided in Ed Sheeran's case in favor, saying that he did not steal the intellectual property of Marvin Gaye and their family. But I was thinking about that a lot because you don't have to be a music nerd to go very far into music to recognize that we borrow people's music all the time. and use it. And I think that's a little thing that we're going to have to continue to wrestle with as our culture gets more and more connected. What is the difference between inspiration and cultural appropriation? You know, what's the difference between being inspired by somebody and stealing somebody's music? And the reason that that is becoming more of an issue now is because of our electronic connectedness. We notice the connections more. We see them more. And we have this concept that, especially with music, what is intellectual property? I don't, many of you probably in my generation remember Napster and remember saying, well, if I bought the CD, I have the right to share that music with whoever I want to share it with. But does that honor the artist who created that music? And so there's this ongoing debate in terms of how we honor the role of music in the world and honor the role of music in our lives. And I'm not here to tell you what the answer is to any of that, but what it made me think about was the variations on a theme that happen over the course of these centuries. So just a brief list of musicians that have borrowed from other musicians. And this is really, I mean, I spent 5 minutes on Google. This is not, you know, a deeply researched topic. So if I found this much in 5 minutes, imagine how much more there is. So Billy Joel, his song This Night, you will recognize that melody if you listen to Beethoven's Pathetic Sonata. It's beautiful melody. You can understand why he would do it. But every time I would hear it, I thought, oh, that sounds so familiar. Why does that sound familiar? Well, because my dad listens to a lot of classical music. So I heard this melody. Lady Gaga's Alejandro borrows from Vittorio Mondi's Sardas, which is also based on a Hungarian folk dance. So it's also based on two other artists. Eric Carmen's All By Myself borrows from Rachmaninoff's Piano Concerto No. 2 in C minor. So we've got lots of variations that happen. Maroon 5's Memories may sound reminiscent of Pachelbel's Canon in D. White Stripes' Seven Nation Army borrows from Bruckner's Symphony No. 5. Elvis Presley's It's Now or Never, this one surprised me, borrowed from Eduardo DiCaprio's O Sole Mio. Yeah, right? That surprised me. John Denver's Annie's Song is reminiscent of Tchaikovsky's Symphony No. 5. Beatles' Because, now this is kind of a rather famous one. John Lennon's wife, Yoko Ono, was playing Beethoven's Moonlight Sonata, and he told her to play it in reverse, play the chords in reverse, and that was the inspiration for the Beatles song, Because. Yeah, right? There's lots of different things that we are inspired by that become incorporated into the music that we know. Does that make these artists unoriginal? Perhaps the worst commentary you can make on an artist? Are they unoriginal by borrowing from people, by being inspired by people? Or does it simply make the arts of the original song artists that inspired? Maybe they are that inspired and moved by the other artists. Even classical artists sample themselves when they write variations on a theme. And so if you'll see in classical music, there'll be a certain clip or phrase of music that caught the artist's ear, and they want it played by various instruments in varied phrasings and dynamics and rhythms. So you'll hear a melody in an orchestra that's passed around the whole orchestra, and then occasionally you'll hear the whole orchestra play it together with layers of harmonies. So what do we do? What does this mean for our faith? Why is that? I mean, how does that make any difference on our faith? Well, this is going to be a little call and response portion of our sermon, so I'm going to ask you to provide me with a few things here, but I'm going to set you up. So we have variations on the themes in our scripture, but they all come down to basic core themes. What are the themes of your faith that you picked up from the people that inspired you to have faith in the first place? The first one I already gave you, God is love. It's probably the central tenet of most of our Christian faith. What other themes do we have that we might share in different ways or be picked up throughout the scripture?
Forgiveness.
Forgiveness. It is shown in multiple parables, in multiple stories of Jesus' life, and in multiple stories throughout the Old Testament. What else? What are themes of our faith? Grace. Grace and love, the choir told us, are free. That's from a scripture in Isaiah. Come to the water, all you who are hungry. Anybody who doesn't have anything, you can come here and you can get grace and love, and it doesn't cost you a cent. Grace and love are free and they're available to everybody. That is a theme throughout scripture. What are other themes?
Fellowship.
Everybody gathers together. Where two or three are gathered in my name. The disciples gathered in an upper room. They gathered on a hillside to listen to Jesus. And it's multiple places in the Old Testament as well, when the prophets gathered them together through the wilderness and shared with them what they needed to hear. The Good Shepherd is not just found when Jesus says, I am the Good Shepherd, but it's also echoed in various places in the Old Testament. Music. Music is a theme throughout scripture. We have an entire book called Psalms, which are just songs. It's a song book. We don't know what the music sounded like, but it's songs. And not just in that, but throughout the scriptures, we have music being used. When they passed over the Red Sea, Miriam danced and sang a song of victory and celebration. Leadership is a theme throughout. We have, and that even is a riff on the Good Shepherd too, where leadership is, what is a good leader? And good leaders are lifted up, and God looks on the heart, not just the outside. So good leader has specific attributes, and that's detailed throughout the Old Testament, and we see the ultimate leader in Jesus.
Reconciliation.
So not only is forgiveness real, but reconciliation is possible. That God's grace brings us back together again. What a beautiful theme that gives so many of us hope. Discipleship, that we are to learn about our faith. Love your neighbor as yourself. That wonderful golden rule that so many world religions have expands so many things about who is your neighbor, how do you love them? And what does love look like? Is love just being kind, or is it also treating them fairly with kindness? Our themes look different for us based on when we hear them in our lives. So when we say God is love, that may have looked and sounded one way as a child, one way as a youth, one way as a parent, and one way as a grandparent. It may hit us and inspire us in different ways. Yet it's the same core message that you live out. God is love. And so if God is love and I want to become godly, how do I love as a child? How do I love as a youth and a teenager? How do I love as a parent? And how do I love as a grandparent? How do I love as a friend? What does love look like? It's different based on where you are in your life. God loves everyone. That message hits very differently as a kid who felt awkward and excluded versus a teenager who didn't really want to reach outside of our comfort zone to include that one person who was kind of odd. But that God loves everyone is not just a message of comfort that God loves us, it's a message of challenge that we have to share that message with others and make sure that they know that they are loved by God. It's a variation, perhaps, on that love your neighbor as you love yourself. We can find so many different ways to say those themes and share them. And yet it's the same God at the core of all of those themes. I encourage you to notice the themes in your life and notice when those themes are pulled out of you and when those themes are struggling. And when you notice them, perhaps that's when God, the great composer of all of our lives, is trying to draw a particular melody out of your life. And it might be that theme of forgiveness or grace or reconciliation or love that God is working on in your life. Pay attention to the themes that are being lived out in your life. Pay attention to the themes that inspired you in your friends and in your family and your loved ones. May your life sing out the truths of God in all of its different variations throughout the course of your life. May you hear that theme echoed in the actions of your loved ones as much as in your own life. And may our music truly glorify and honor God, the most creative force that gives us the very gift of creativity itself. Let us pray. Holy God, we are blessed to be able to make your music. The melodies that you pull from our hearts are melodies of love and grace and forgiveness. And sometimes we find those discordant notes of envy and bitterness or jealousy or anger. And we pray, Lord, that you would take those discordant notes and give momentum to our music so that we may come to a reconciliation in our lives, so that we may come to a final chord that is pleasing and complete. In God's holy name we pray. Amen. I invite you to stand as we sing our hymn. It's the insert in your bulletin. Come sing, O church, in joy. May I invite you to sing with vigor. Well, if you're ready to doodle your prayers, you can use the back of your insert if you'd like. What are the joys and the concerns that we'd like to lift up together today? Roberta. Oh, yeah, Matt's coming. He's got you.
I would just like everybody to keep Adam, my son, in your prayers as he struggles with some issues of his personal life.
First of all, I would like all of you to keep Madison in your prayers. She has expanded her journey to places currently unknown, so she needs all the help that we can supply. Additionally, I've been feeling some of you praying about my arm today in church because it has been vibrating. So I don't know if that's you guys or the music or a little of both, but thank you for all your prayers. I'm making amazing progress.
Wonderful. I just ask for continued prayers for my niece, Savannah. They did some testing and they're still waiting for the results.
Yeah, prayers for my sister, Helen. She's finally going to get her surgery on Tuesday and hopefully corrects the problems that are going on. And Buck continues his struggle.
We will pray. Thanks, Joe. Let's be a people of prayer. Redeeming God, you call us to devote ourselves constantly to prayer for the sake of Jesus Christ. Therefore, we offer our prayers this day on behalf of your church and the world, asking you to fill us with your Spirit's power that we may be one with Christ as Christ is one with you. Rescuing God, parent of orphans and protector of widows, you give the desolate a home to live in and lead out the prisoners into prosperity. Help us to order the patterns of our common life to support the health of your human family and the welfare of the world. Steadfast God, you have given to your church the inheritance of faith in Christ alone and bestowed your Spirit's love upon us to make us one in you. Help us to grow in strength and courage to witness to this hope that all may find your saving love eternally in Christ. Fill us with your Spirit's power that we may be one with Christ as Christ is one with you. Living God, you send rain in abundance to relieve the parched crops and the thirsty land and make clean the winds of heaven. Help us to find sustainable solutions as we seek to honor and care for the well-being of your creation. Loving God, you heard the sufferings of your people. You listened to our cries and sent a son into our world that was no stranger to our pain. Help us to offer your healing and compassion as we minister to others in the mercy of your Christ. Fill us with your Spirit's power that we may be one with Christ as Christ is one with you. Lord, we lift up to you those that we've named this morning. We ask that you be with each and every one of them in their difficulties, that you would be with Adam and Madison and Cheryl and Savannah and Helen and Bucky. We ask that you would surround them with your love and your mercy and your grace, that you would move each of them to healing, mind, body, and soul, that you would care for and protect them, and that you would make your presence known to them. We lift up to you, Lord, those prayers that we have not named out loud, but that we name to you in our hearts silently. You are the Lord of all, and you are our Lord, and we are so grateful to find safety in your presence. Resurrecting God, you draw near to those who are sick and dying, and you call them home to you. May we all know the joy of life eternal shared with you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Praise is the
Jesus said that all mine are yours and all yours are mine. Therefore, let us offer to God this day our lives and labor in service to Christ's love. Let us bring our tithes and offerings to the Lord. Will you join with me, please, in our prayer of dedication? Let us pray. Glorious God, everything that is given to us brings forth out of the abundance of your love, even Jesus Christ our Lord. Bless these gifts and our lives together, that all we are and all we offer give glory to you. In the name of Christ, who is the way, truth, and life. Amen. I invite you to join in singing our closing hymn number 561, When in Our Music God is Glorified.
You have been ministered to by a whole lot of fantastic ministers. And so I say to you, thank you for your ministry. And may, as you have blessed us with our music, may it have blessed your faith as well. And may you hear the words of that final hymn, that you are an instrument of the Lord. And may it let every instrument be tuned for praise. Let all rejoice who have a voice to raise, and may God give us faith to sing always. Alleluia. May the grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all this day and every day.